Hi folks, my name's Jason, and it's good to be with you today. And it's Sunday evening, and I've got three or four Bible study sermons to do, to share with you today. And we're looking at Psalm 91, if you'd like to turn to Psalm 91. So let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your love and your grace, and we confess our failure and sin and the weakness of our hearts. We acknowledge, O God, that we need you, that we need your forgiveness, we need your grace, we need your mercy. And so, Father, we ask for your forgiveness today. We ask that you might be pleased to bless this sermon for your glory. And may it be a blessing to people, may it be a blessing to their hearts. And may they know your love and grace, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You'd like to turn to Psalm 91. It says, "He that dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in Him will I trust. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid of the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, and 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. Only with thy eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. Because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation, there shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. For he shall give his angels charge over thee, to keep thee on all thy ways. They shall bear thee up in their hands, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he hath known my name. He shall call upon me, and I will answer him, and I will be with him in trouble. And I will deliver him and honour him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation." We're looking at the security of the believer. The security of the believer. Just as there are crown jewels in the Tower of London, and they are precious to the Queen and precious to the government, so we are precious. We are jewels to God. If you turn to Isaiah chapter 49, verse 15, Isaiah, and if you have a Bible, please get your Bible out. Don't just listen to me, but check what I say as we look at the Word of God. Isaiah 49, verse 15. It says, "Can a woman forget a suckling child, that she should not have compassion on the son of her womb? Yea, they may forget, yet will I not forget thee. Yet will I not forget thee." God will not forget you. He will look after you. He cares for you. If you read Jeremiah 29 verse 11, it says, "I know the thoughts I have for you, plans to prosper you, to give you hope and a future." God has a plan for you. In the midst of your struggles, in the midst of your pains, God is with you. Jeremiah chapter 31 verse 3. Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 3. Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 3. "The Lord hath appeared of old unto me, saying, Ye, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Before, with loving kindness, have I drawn thee." I have loved thee with an everlasting love. God has an everlasting love for you. And then, if you look at 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18, in that verse, it talks about that Christ has redeemed you with his precious blood. Not with gold or silver, but with precious blood. If you bought a Ferrari car, a yellow Ferrari car, and you paid a lot of money out for it, you'd want to protect it and make sure that it wouldn't be damaged. But God didn't pay out money for you. He paid out his own precious blood for you. And so if he's paid out precious blood for you, he is going to want to protect you and be with you and bless you. In Psalm 91, verse 11 and 12, the devil quotes that verse in Matthew chapter 4, verse 6. If you read Matthew chapter 4, verse 6, the devil tries to tempt the Lord and says, you know, cast yourself over, the angels will protect you. And there's a lesson there in the interpretation of this psalm. This psalm is talking about we're not going to get hurt, we're not going to have any difficulties, etc. So how do we interpret that? Because sometimes we do suffer. Well, when the devil quoted this psalm, the Lord did not look at it in a literal way. You see, he didn't stop himself from suffering. He later went on to die on the cross for us. So this psalm, you should be careful not to take it too literally, because if you take it too literally, you know, you're going to find yourself in difficulty. Sometimes we do go through difficulties. Sometimes we do go through pain. What this psalm is saying is that God will protect you and be with you, spiritually speaking. That's not to say he won't deliver you, he won't heal you. God is a healer, God is a deliverer. But spiritually speaking, he has got your back, he's there with you. And I want to talk about three things. The security of the believer. Number one, the security of the believer is in a personal relationship with God. There was a Salvation Army girl on a train, and she saw a bishop, and she thought, here's my opportunity to witness to this bishop. So she went to witness to him, but she didn't realize it was Bishop Hanley Moore, a very godly evangelical bishop. He pulled out his Bible, and he quoted some scripture and said, I'm saved from sin, I'm saved from the power of sin, and I'll be saved in the future in glory. You know, the bishop, Hanley Moore, had a personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. And in Psalm 91, verse 1 and 2, it says, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in him I will trust. God is a person that this psalmist knows. It's Moses who's written this psalm. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge, my fortress, my God in whom I trust, my. He has this personal relationship with God. The word Most High means he is the God who owns you. The word Almighty means he has all power. Imagine a school child being bullied at school, and he comes home, tells his father, who's about 6 foot, and the father goes to school with him, and the children come out and they see this great big 6 foot man, and a shadow casts over his son. You know, the children know that guy, the little boy they bullied, is now protected by their father. They can see the shadow over the son. And you are covered with the shadow of the Lord. The Lord goes before you. The Lord is with you. But it's a personal relationship. Verse 14, Psalm 91, verse 14. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high, because he hath known my name. He has known my name. But he loves him. The psalmist loves God. And God will deliver you if you love him and put him first in your life. Not seeking help from drugs or seeking help in helping relationships that are not good for you. You need to seek your help in God. You need to have a love for him. Psalm 17, verse 8. Let's go to them. Please get your Bible out. Psalm 17, verse 8. Says, keep me as the apple of thy eye. Hide me under the shadow of thy wings. Psalm 27, verse 5. For in the time of trouble, he shall hide me in the pavilion, in the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me, he shall set me upon a rock. Psalm 37 verse 7. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. Fret not thyself because of him who prospereth in his way, because of the man who bringeth wicked devices to pass. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for him. It's this personal relationship of abiding with God, dwelling in his presence, seeking his face. It's personal. Animals, when they're under stress and in danger, know where to hide. A badger, if it's going to be attacked, will go and run to its hole. A fox will run and be able to hide in the bramble. A lion cub will go to its mother and hide in its paws. When you're in danger, where do you go? Where will you hide? Will you flee to something that is not healthy, or will you flee to the presence of God? And if you flee to the presence of God, you'll be okay. Proverbs 18:10. Proverbs 18:10. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and is safe. The name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the righteous run into it and they are safe. Number two, the security of the believer is all-encompassing. The security of the believer is all-encompassing. When you're on when you go on holiday, it's good to get all the bases covered, to make sure you've got your passport, to make sure you've got everything that you need when you're going on holiday. My family once went on holiday to Spain, and one of my sisters is very, very well-traveled, and she told the rest of my family to make sure that they've got sun cream for their faces and their body, and they went onto the beach and they sat in the sun of the Spain, in Spain beach with the sun beating down, and they didn't have any sun oil, and they all came back to their hotel absolutely burnt to a crisp. They didn't have the base covered with the sun cream. But God has got your base covered. All areas of your life, God has got it in hand. Verse 3. Surely he shall deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence, even from anybody who's trying to trick you, anybody who's trying to get at you. He's got the base covered. He's going to look after you. Verse 4. He shall cover thee with his feathers. Under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. He's going to cover you and protect you. He's got your base covered. Verse 5. You don't have to be afraid. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day. What are you afraid of? There's a story of a guy who was a security guard of a museum. And when he went into the museum at night, he went through a door and he looked to the side and he saw a mummy, and it scared him. And so we can live in life full of fear, but God is telling us not to be fearful, because God has got all bases covered. Verse 6. Nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. No matter what's coming against you, he's got it covered. Even an army that comes against you. Verse 7. 1,000 shall fall at thy side, 10,000 at thy right hand, but it shall not come nigh thee. God has got it covered. Things happen out of the blue. Things go difficult. My own father, the other day, it was in hospital. Seriously, seriously ill. It just happened like that. Critically ill. We don't know what's coming. But in the midst of the difficulty, in the midst of the trial, God has got all bases covered for you. You don't have to be afraid. If you turn to Ruth chapter 2, verse 12. Ruth chapter 2, verse 12 says, "The Lord recompense thy work, and a full reward be given thee of the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings thou art come to trust." Ruth had come to trust in the wings of God, and God had provided for her. She had no resources, yet God provided for her. Psalm 36, verse 7. Psalm 36, verse 7. How excellent is thy loving kindness, O God! Therefore the children of men put their trust under the shadow of thy wings. We can trust in the presence and blessings of God. He's got all bases covered. Whether it be sickness, whether it be enemies, whether it be gossip, whatever it is, God is with you and will sustain you. The security of the believer is invincible. The security of the believer is invincible. At the time of D-Day, when the Allies were coming over the coast and invading Normandy, the beach of Normandy, and they hit the German lines, one of the untold stories in that battle is the logistics of providing all the necessary equipment and food for those soldiers. Hundreds of thousands of soldiers needed to be fed every day. That means tons and tons of food, tons and tons of ammunition, thousands and thousands and thousands of tons of ammunition and food had to be provided to the troops each day so that they could fight. And they had enough supply. The supply was there. The resources were there for them to march forward. Well, we have a greater resource, and that is God. Verse 8, Psalm 91, verse 8. Only with thy eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked. You will see your enemies fail before your very eyes. Verse 10. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. No matter what comes against you, God is going to make a way for you. Verse 11. You even have angels on your side, for he shall give his charge over thee, his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways. No matter how difficult the battle is, no matter how ferocious the enemy is, verse 13, thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample under feet. No matter how much the enemy rages, you will win victoriously. As we go to him in prayer, verse 15, he shall call upon me and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. Why do you go through hardships? You say, Jay, if God's going to protect me and be with me, why is it that I find it hard? Why is it that I go through difficulties? Well, the old word, the old term that theologians of centuries ago used to use is divine chastisement. Why is it this psalm is saying we're not going to go through difficulties and yet we go through difficulties? What is it saying? Well, the psalm here, Psalm 91, is saying, look, spiritually speaking, I'm with you. I'm going to help you in every trial and difficulty. I am with you and you will be victorious. You will go forward. But that doesn't mean to say you're not going to suffer sometimes. The Lord suffered. The Lord went to the cross. And divine chastisement doesn't necessarily mean that if you sin, he chastises you. That's true. God does chastise us like that. But the old saints used the word divine chastisement to mean that God takes us through things and difficult paths in order to sanctify us, in order to teach us lessons, in order to prepare us for better things and for the future. So sometimes God doesn't give us what we want because he's testing us and purifying us and strengthening our faith. That is what is meant by the old term of the ancient writers when they mean divine chastisement. So that's a digression, but we do go through difficulties. And that's just to explain that. But here, the psalmist is saying, I'm with you. God is with you. He's going to be with you. He's going to come through for you. You have angelic hosts on your side. Exodus 23. Exodus 23. Exodus 23. Verse 20. Behold, I send an angel before thee to keep thee in thy way, and to bring thee into the place which I prepared. Beware of him, obey his voice, provoke him not, for he will not pardon your transgression, for my name is in him. But if thou shalt indeed obey his voice, and do all that I speak, then I will be an enemy unto thy enemies, and an adversary unto thine adversary. For my angel shall go before thee, and bring thee in unto the Amorites, and Hittites, and the Perizzites, and the Canaanites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites, and I will cut them off. That Moses is being told by God that I will send an angel before thee, and I will defend my people. And God goes before you, and angels will defend you. You might feel you've got no resources, you might feel embattled, you might feel the enemy is overwhelmingly too big, too difficult for you, but you have angelic hosts on your side. 2 Kings 19:35. 2 Kings 19:35. And it came to pass that night that the angel of the Lord went out and smote the camp of the Assyrians 185,000. When they arose early in the morning, behold, they were all dead corpses. Sennacherib's army was vanquished, hundreds of thousands of soldiers were destroyed by an angel, by angels. God is on your side. Even angels are defending you. Imagine you have a child called Bobby. He's 5 years of age. You take him to school. And he goes into the playground as you see him go in the morning when you drop him off at school. Bobby's got a yellow cap and he's sucking a red lollipop. And in the afternoon you go and pick up Bobby. And there in the crowd, you notice your son, Bobby. You go to him, you pick him up, and you give him a hug. You've noticed him in the crowd. That's what Psalm 91 is doing. It's saying, God takes note of you. You are a son and daughter. And in the midst of the crowd of life, he has his eye and love and affection set upon you. Psalm 124. Psalm 124. Come on, if you haven't got your Bible out, get your Bible out. Stop being lazy. Psalm 124. If it had not been that the Lord who was on our side, now may Israel say, if it had not been the Lord who was on our side, when men rose up against us, then they swallowed us up quick. When their wrath was kindled against us, then the waters had overwhelmed us, the streams had gone over our soul, then the proud waters had gone over our soul. Blessed be the Lord who had not given us a prey to their teeth. Our soul is escaped as a bird out of the snare of the fowler. The snare is broken and we are escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth. The Lord is with you. Final conclusion. What is troubling you? What afflicts you? What are you concerned about? What concerns you? Psalm 91, verse 1 and 2 is the answer. He that dwell in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God. In Him will I trust. Go and flee to God. When it says in verse 1, abide under the shadow of the Almighty, Bedouins in the ancient world. If you were to go into the tent of a Bedouin, a chief of someone, and you were to go into the tent, you automatically come under their protection. They feel obliged to protect you. They feel obliged to provide for you. Do you remember when Lot, the angels came and the people wanted to come and sleep with them, and Lot was concerned to protect those angels? So as you go before the Lord, when you're in His presence, and under the shadow of His wings, then He is obliged to protect you. He is obliged to defend you. He is obliged to be there for you. That is what it means when it says, under the shadow of the Almighty. Athanasius says, if you want to be fearless, meditate on this psalm. The rabbis say, the old rabbis said that, when you're sick, meditate 7 times on this psalm. Now I want to give a few little applications from a great Puritan writer, Thomas Watson. Thomas Watson said, Christ went more willingly to the cross than we do to the throne of grace. Christ went more willingly to the cross than we do to the throne of grace. Why do we reluctantly, in the midst of our struggles, go to the throne? Let's go quickly to the throne of grace and seek His help in the time of trouble. Thomas Watson, the great Puritan, said, a weak faith can lay hold on a strong Christ. You might feel weak and difficult, things are difficult, but as you go to Christ, He is strong and He will hold you in the midst of this problem. Thomas Watson said, it is our work to cast care, and it is God's work to take care. Let us put our care upon the Lord, and He will carry us and take care of us. And finally, Thomas Watson, the great Puritan, and get hold of his books, The Worth His Weight in Gold, said, Satan loves to fish in the troubled waters of discontented heart. Satan loves to fish in the troubled waters of a discontented heart. If we're discontented, then Satan can come and make war and trouble with us. So let us be content, and by looking and stirring our affections and our minds towards Christ. So we've finished. Let us turn to Psalm 147, verse 3. 147, verse 3. He healeth the broken in heart and bindeth up the wounds. Bindeth up the wounds. He heals the brokenhearted. No matter how much you've been battered by life or battered by a tongue, say maybe someone has been nasty with you or people have been nasty with you, no matter how much you have been battling with tongues who have hurt you, no matter how much you have been battling in ministry, in your life, in your family, God heals the brokenhearted. Matthew 11:28. Matthew 11:28. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and what? I will give you rest. Let us go to God. In the midst of our trial, let us go to God in the midst of our problems. Let us go to God, meditate and trust in Him. And we will find rest for our souls. We will find manna for our hearts. And we will be refreshed. The great Baptist preacher, Charles Spurgeon, who loved the Puritans, who was a great preacher. As a young minister in London, round about 1850 to 1851, a plague of some kind of cholera, some kind of serious illness or disease spread throughout London and was taking many lives. Many were dying, and this young minister Spurgeon was going around visiting families, even his friends, and seeing them die before his very eyes. And he was so taken aback with the difficulties and the struggles that he was weighed down and he could hardly bear it anymore. One day, as he was walking home, feeling dejected and tired and discouraged and wanting to give up, he chanced on a shop window, and in the shop window was the verses from Psalm 91. And as he read them, it comforted his heart. If you read Psalm 91 every day and get it into your soul, you will be refreshed, you will be strengthened, you will be encouraged, and your heart, you'll be lifted up out of any despondency, any discouragement that you face today or any time in the future. May God bless you. Let us pray. Father, we're conscious that it's easy to not trust you and to get discouraged. But there are some going through great trials today. Some finding it very, very hard. And I pray, dear Father God, that they would read this psalm. And I pray that you would lift their hearts and strengthen them, that they might know your love, that they might know your grace. Bless them, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Don't forget my website, jasonburnspreacher.com. And I have a Twitter account that I put stuff on most days. It might be pictures and comments and videos and things that will edify you, build you up, that are sound. So there's the Twitter, and then there is Facebook, where I put videos on and also comments and things that will edify you. And then there's this YouTube channel, and then there is a website. And you can get to all these multimedia from my website, jasonburnspreacher.com. And within that little world of the Twitter, the Facebook, and the YouTube and the website is some really good material that will build you up and encourage you and strengthen you in your faith and really encourage you to go forward. I have a good nose for sound teaching. I have a good nose for that which will build you up. And my discernment you can trust, and it will be a blessing to you if you go onto those four platforms. You'll be blessed and encouraged and strengthened in your faith. So I hope you've been blessed. Please pray for me. Please continue to pray for the work that I do, for the evangelism. And I value your support and prayers. So please keep praying. And thank you for listening. And God bless you. I'm going to preach a couple of more sermons, maybe just one more sermon, and call it a day. All right. Thank you for listening. God bless you.